And welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the Monastery, the open bar of the internet, the world's greatest shit show, and the place where we, the good brothers and sisters of this most holy of temples, seek enlightenment through the drunkest, craziest, the most batshit ways possible. I am your one and only gaming monk, better known as Milja, and with me I have not one but two newcomers to the temple. The proverbial two-headed monster that is Pugware, creators of the Skautfold series, which recently released its newest chapter with Moonless Night. Steve and Victoria Gao, how are you two doing tonight?
Fine, thank
Very
you.
Good, thanks.
Yeah, hopefully I didn't go too surprisey with that intro. I'd like to start off with a bang.
No, it's fine.
Mm-hmm. So, I'd like to open up with a bit of a tradition around here. No, aside from the drinking. In the humble beginnings. So, what I'm curious about is where'd the game design spark really start? Like, what would you say was the thing that planted the seed?
It's like very hard to say.
A question that we did together. So basically, in the beginning of our relationship, we stayed together by playing Lineage 2. So we are an RPG couple. And basically, we were always gaming together. And that was his dream, to make video games. I didn't really know in the beginning what I wanted to do with my life. And when he decided that, okay, he's going to tell his stories through video games, then I decided to help him, and basically we made it happen together.
Mm-hmm. I think my desire for it started like very early, possibly on Atari 2600. Not that I'm that old, but that's the hardware that I started with. And I already was fascinated by games in general, but I just couldn't imagine actually doing it, because I was told a lie that you need very, very good math, and otherwise you can't code anything. And I completely disagree with that. You just need very good logic, and actually, if you're just good with foreign languages, you're probably going to be great at coding. So once I learned that lie for what it is, I was like, I might as well try it. So I started small, but yeah, I had it all my life, basically, since childhood. But it was like a secret, dirty desire, you know?
It's funny you mentioned the math thing, because having a background with tabletop, I hear that excuse a lot. That the reason why somebody can't get into it is because they're not good at math. Which is always funny to me, because if somebody can handle basic arithmetic, PEMDAS, they'll be fine.
Yeah, you don't need anything really complex, especially for like games, unless you're coding actual new hardware, software, like actual OS or whatever. You're not gonna need it.
No, and especially these days when there's plenty of engines that are freely available.
Yeah, if you don't write your own engine, that I don't see that you're gonna need high end math.
It's interesting that both of you cited Lineage 2 earlier. Putting aside the fact that that's not a game that I hear brought up often, and I will freely admit that my own ignorance, because of how unaware I am when it comes to the gaming scene in Hungary. But Was it a case of? I know that there is. I know that in the case of Lineage, it was built around the whole internet cafe thing in Asia. Was there a similar thing in Hungary, or was it just good old fashioned PC on a desk?
The latter. On a desk mostly, it's like whatever was easily available at the time. I would guess, but it's like mostly I started to play it because I was really impressed with how beautiful it looks. Because I didn't really like Warcraft because I just like pretty things, you know. And it, to me, it didn't look that pretty at the time because I was like, how old? Like 14, 15 when I started playing with it.
And online games got really popular in Hungary pretty early the time, because there was good internet infrastructure. So unlike in the US, there was already megabits of internet available good 20 years ago, pretty much. No, not 20, but like good 15, 16 years ago.
All right, that makes sense. Now moving into the Skautfold series. I'm hoping I got that pronunciation right.
Yeah, don't worry about it. It's Skautfold, something like that. It doesn't really matter, to be honest. It's not really meant to be in English anyway. Or Hungarian.
In my defense, I've had people screw up my name, so I try and be as accurate as I can. But first off, the question that I wanted to ask, and this is a minor one that's leading into the bigger one. What was the origin of that name?
It's basically a certain version of Norse where it's combined. I can kind of spoil it. It's not really a spoiler, but it doesn't really say much. But it's meant to be actually Scout and Fjord, which Fjord is world, right? Mm-hmm. And the Scout is supposed to be a separating line or a border or stuff like that. It has many translations, so it's supposed to combine kind of like border world. It's just, I don't know. I actually don't remember why the way I picked it up, but that's the way it kind of sounded really cool, to be honest, mm-hmm. to me. So it probably was the rule of cool.
Like, if we go all the way back, then basically this story that the games tell and the story that we are trying to get to, so Skautfold is only the start. We have many plans for many games, but like the story originally was called Border. And basically the Border is a realm of gods where they live in his story, which he started to draw a comic book of, like, ages and ages ago. So this is something that he imagined long time ago, and it was just developing from that. And when we started game development in 2015, then Dark Souls and Souls-like games and things like that started to become popular, and basically we just rewritten the same story to match the genre we wanted to start with.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to give the setting a more grounded base before moving into the more crazy stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And so I basically wrote a very long prequel, so to speak, that will lead into that original story. And it just all fit together real nicely. And right in the middle of Shrouded Insanity, I already planned out all five games ahead of time, basically. Their overall story and the whole where it's arching and how it's going to connect to that story. So it's like a very, very long setup.
And so Skautfold was always intended to be a five game series. Is that correct?
Yeah, through the development of Shattered Insanity, I realized that yes, I can do this, and yes, I enjoy this very much. Mm-hmm. So I drawn up the plans, and it all came together really well. And I wanted to make sure that every single one of them will be a different genre that fits the characters the best. Yeah. That is one of the reasons why they are different. And it's also very, very useful for me to learn more. Because if I was thinking that if I just polish the same genre with a direct sequel, with just a number at the end, yes, I will learn about that genre a lot, but I will not learn a lot of valuable lessons. And in retrospect now, I can say that I think I was right, because I learned so much more than I would have just doing the same souls like over and over.
And we'll probably get into the learning thing in a bit. But now, I had first found out about Skautfold through the first chapter, Shrouded Insanity. A lot of people. It's funny you mentioned the Dark Souls popularity, because every time Shrouded Insanity would get brought up, or I'd see it talked about in articles or on threads, the comparison was always to Bloodborne. Which part of that I can easily see because of the kind of setting, for lack of a better term, but was that intentional? Was Bloodborne more of an influence than Souls, or was that coincidental?
The way I started out is that it's actually started out, the whole project was more of a Resident Evil homage, because one of my most formative games was Alone in the Dark, the original 1 and 2 and even 3, before Resident Evil. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I just absolutely loved that. So I was starting to make more of a survival horror, but then the Souls influence did rub off on me. And during development, Bloodborne came out. So that was kind of lucky, kind of unlucky at the same time, because I always envisioned a Victorian setting for it, because that's one of the settings I really love, because that's when science really expanded. And superstition was still possible, but as science expanded, there were new horrors, and the whole theme of Lovecraft, mm-hmm. of understanding how insignificant everyone is compared to the universe, and I just love that period of time when religion and faith collided with science, and I think that was like a really good hotbed for it. So that's why I went Victorian, but then Bloodborne went Victorian. So yeah, everyone thinks it's just Bloodborne, but no, it was much more Souls inspired. The only thing that directly got inspired by Bloodborne was making the gun basically a tool to parry. You know, how it's used in Bloodborne is not really for damage, but for parrying. Mm-hmm. Outside of that, it was originally far more of a survival horror. Like, currently I'm working on patching up Shrouded Insanity for the Nintendo Switch release. Mm-hmm. I'm actually seeing the leftover files still in the game of there was going to be multiple ammo types, for example, which is more of a survival aspect of you were supposed to use the correct ammo for the correct type of enemy to deal far more damage, but it was all going to be a limited resource, you know? Mm-hmm. So there was going to be more to the Resident Evil leaning. And if you look at it that way, you can notice like the reason why, how the manor is laid out and stuff like that. So originally that was far more of an influence. But of course, most people will obviously relate it to the closest thing that they can find in their mind, you know? So they will say, oh, it's Bloodborne.
That's always the reason why I ask these kind of things, because I'm fully aware that while these things might appear to be taking inspiration one way, the true story is always going to be more complicated. When it came to Shrouded Insanity, that was also where I started to see a recurring thing. I'd say a good majority of the storyline for each game in the series has had a motif of somebody accepting a contract with some sort of being outside of this world, or some sort of being with significant power. I'm curious as to, was that an intended motif when you were writing the thing in early on, or was that something that just happened naturally and it just stuck?
I would say that there's two reasons for it. One that is like more metaphorical, and one that is much more practical. So, you know, when you start a new game, but you have an established character of some strength, you always have to undress them, so to speak, depower them. Many, many games struggle with this, like Metroid games, where Samus just keeps getting completely depowered at the beginning again and again and again. She loses all her powers, you know. So part of it is the fact that I gotta depower them somehow, so that they start out weaker, so that the player can, you know, acclimate and get used to their powers and skills and whatever. But another part of it is that story-wise, it's supposed to signify that each of the knights have committed something in Shattered Insanity that I'm not going to spell out. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to spoil the game, but each of the knights that in the following games appear have committed something in Shattered Insanity, and it's basically their punishment catching up to them. If you want to go in a story metaphorical way about it. But yes, there's practicality to it too. So I'm not going to deny that it's also a really good way to depower the player.
Well, there's that, history is riddled with stories that have some sort of deal with the proverbial devil. I say proverbial because none of the deal makers in this situation are the devil. Well, mostly. But I would imagine that making each game is a learning process unto itself. So one of the things I'm curious about is what would you say in hindsight that you learned from the development and release of Shrouded Insanity?
Well, pretty much the most out of all the four of them. For obvious reasons, it was the first game. But just in general, one of the main lessons that I did learn, and I can impart on pretty much every other developer who's struggling to finish their first game, the big lesson is just finish it. Just make it, and I know that you hate it, that it's nowhere near what you want, it's not as good as you want, but you just gotta put it out, and see what happens. And you just have to get through that point, because I see so many developers who just stay on the same project or wander from project to project, never finishing anything. You need to finish something. And once you break that seal of like just making unfinished stuff forever or millions of unfinished projects, once you break that point, I think that's one of the biggest lessons you can learn, is that you need to learn when to finish it, how much to cut back. And like it or not, I regret so many missing features and aspects, but it's never going to be done if you're just listening to your heart of keep going and keep adding and having all these amazing features. Especially in your first game, it's never going to happen. No one is ever going to hit the golden angle or the golden degree on their first attempt, you know. Mm-hmm. That was one of the biggest lessons that I learned, that you just have to accept that, yes, you need to cut down, you need to scale back. You know, if something sounds good on paper, that doesn't mean that it's going to be a great addition to the game. And nothing is better than trying. And I'm talking about actually letting players have at it and having their feedback.
There's just like, what was it like halfway through, almost we had to like completely scrap everything and try a different angle because the scale was just literally too big for us to finish within a year or so.
Yes.
And otherwise our funds wouldn't have lasted. Mm-hmm. And we just had to do it.
Of course. I think the old adage, an artist is their own worst critic, could certainly apply there.
Yes. Well, I really struggle with my work when I have to look at it, but you just have to do it. Otherwise, you're never going to actually learn. It all sounds great on paper, but nothing teaches you more than just having players play it and react. And I learned so much from that, just how the skills of players ranges, and not just skills, but like understanding of what they will get, what they won't get, how much is too much for this, how much is too little for that. And of course, you can never, ever, ever please or make everyone happy. But you learn a lot of how actually extremely wide the range of players are in just so many aspects. So, no, I don't support the Git Good example, but yeah, there's a lot of things that you only gonna learn once your game is out. And you really need to get through that as soon as possible if you're planning to make more than one game in your life.
Yeah. Which brings us to the second instance, and this is, I know a few people who ended up jumping into this one because of their love for Castlevania. When it came to, for the first one with Shrouded Insanity, you definitely had a very top down approach, and then with Usurper, the second game in the series, you went with a more side scrolling, almost Castlevania approach. And what I'm curious about is, was the transition between styles between those two games, was that easier or harder than you thought it was going to be?
Well, it wasn't hard. To be honest, because I always had an understanding of platformers, at least to a degree. So, and what I learned from the hardest parts that I had to learn was mostly applicable to Usurper as well. So while the perspective is different, there's only one really new aspect to the change in perspective from top down to 2D, and that's how you handle gravity and all that, you know, and the physics of jumping and movement. That's different, but otherwise a large percentage of the game, like logic of AI and pathfinding and stuff like that, a lot of that applies there. A lot of it transitions without issue into the other project. Mm-hmm. So you don't really lose as much as you would think. You know, the very big difference between the two is only that one is just well, like a beat 'em up, and the other is more involved with the jumping. But outside of that aspect of jumping and movement, the rest is completely applicable. So it's not as big a jump as you would think.
Yeah. One of the things I was curious about was what was the story behind going into that more platformer like approach for the second game? Was that something you had planned early on, or how?
Basically, it's like I said, that the character drives the direction that the genre will take. So Saragat is the main character of the second game, and he's supposed to be the most agile of the knights. He's supposed to be the faster and more agile and more movement-focused of the knights. So I always wanted something faster for him or more jumpy. So it kind of drove me into that direction that, okay, if I do jumping, then obviously the Metroidvania would be the choice because that's one of my favorite genres. So that's where I would go with it next. So that it's kind of the character that drove it that way.
And of course with that there was also change in art style feels a bit off, but a greater inclusion when it comes to character art. One thing I was curious about with it is the is the creation of the guard setup that you had for Usurper. Because I've seen some make comparisons to traditional souls like stamina and some in other ways. So I'm curious what the mentality was when it came to creating that mechanic.
Okay, that mechanic I've been basically thinking about and implementing before even I knew that I could make games. In my youth, I got really annoyed how, and this will sound weird, how in a lot of JRPGs, the combat seemed to have been boiled down to just hit and heal. I really didn't like how in a lot of them you could just completely circumvent any kind of tactics or skill by just hitting the enemy a lot while healing yourself a lot, you know. Mm-hmm. A lot of the bad JRPGs have boiled down to that, where there's nothing really anything else that you need to do. So since I was like a teenager, I was trying to figure out a way to make it, to come up with a combat system that would still be turn-based, but would not have this this universe where you have to have healing magic or healing spells or potions, you know. Mm-hmm. It was just a minor annoyance of mine, and that actually led me to the creation of the guard system very, very early on. And it was something I shelved in my mind forever. I always was dreaming up my dream game and everything, which would have been an action RPG, real time using the guard system. Mm-hmm. So I actually tried to put it into Shrouded Insanity, but I didn't feel like it was fitting. There's still a build on Steam that if I could make it active, it would be actually in right now. So it was almost in Shrouded Insanity, but I was thinking that, okay, that's way too much. I shouldn't mess with it now. Like Vic said, that we just had to, you know, finish it and I can't redo it again. So I put it into Usurper. And mainly it's about eliminating healing. And that's why in Usurper there's no way to heal. Because that's always been my pet peeve as a teenager, that, oh, why do we need this healing magic? You know, there's other ways to represent how in real combat, you know, you don't get hit all the time. You're not going to walk off someone hitting you with a giant greatsword. In real combat, you either evade that or you kind of block it. But mm-hmm. I was always thinking of how could you make it into a mechanic, into a game, where your character automatically blocks it, but you lose some kind of resource that represents that you're on the defensive, you know. That's how the whole thing formed. Yep.
Now, taking that into account, I'll ask what I had previously asked when it came to Shrouded in Sanity. What would you say was the major takeaway and what you learned from the development after the fact when it came to it?
The biggest takeaway was from it that that would be a lot. If I don't want to get too technical, don't build systems that are completely self. Well, I don't know. Like, don't build systems into the game that are too integrated into other systems, because anything you need to change, you will have to completely mess with every other system. I don't know. I can't find the right words for it, but the point is that make systems modular and easy to take, add and remove. Otherwise, you're going to have a lot of problems if you have to go back and fix anything up. And this is something that I will have to actually do in a few months, go back and fix up Usurper for the Switch release as well. And that's a nightmare I'm looking forward to. There's a lot of really interconnected code that shouldn't have been done that way. That's one of the things I learned from that. The biggest things.
Now, of course, with the next one, that was Into the Fray. And with that one, we end up going full a bit more of a traditional, a bit more in the line of a traditional action game as opposed to an action RPG.
Yes.
Now, much like with Usurper, was that also a result of it being a reflection of the character you were playing as?
Yes. The third game's character is Hito, mm-hmm. who was always gonna have two options for his game. It was either gonna be a stealth game, a stealth survival horror kind of game, or it's gonna be a shooter. It might have been an FPS. Have I been more studious? Basically, I didn't want to take the risk of going FPS with it. I had basically dreamed of it, of like having a classic Doom style FPS. But in the end, I sat down for something I knew better, and I knew that I could finish without having to enter development hell, and that was a twin stick shooter. And yes, again, the character drove the choice, because he was either going to be a stealth or a full-on shooter. And I went with the twin-stick approach, basically.
And when it came to the question of doing the stealth approach, was that a case of the materials you just had didn't work out with that, or why can you say why that got dropped?
Okay, so I have a very, very high standard when it comes to stealth games. I love the genre, and way too few games exist in the genre that are actually good. And therefore, I was like, I was basically considering that I always ramp on these games that are doing it incorrect. And I know for a fact that I couldn't do a good enough AI at that time. Because I have very, like I said, a very high barrier where I would consider a stealth game to be good. And a lot of it depends on the AI. And I was thinking through it of, could I make it now? And I concluded that, no, I'm not ready yet. I still need to learn a lot before I would put myself through the test of creating actually good stealth AI.
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't want to. I didn't want to contribute to bad stealth games, basically. I didn't feel like I was ready for it, skill-wise.
Alright. When it came to the whole concept of doing a twin stick, was that a genre that you had a background with early on, like in your early days?
Basically, I play just about every kind of game outside of sports games and racing games. Outside of that, I partake in almost all of the genres. Everything, basically. I always loved all these different games for different, entirely different reasons. Mm-hmm. Well, I would say the only games that I really don't play are racing games, sports games, and roguelikes. Very few roguelikes that I actually enjoy. Very, very, very few. Okay. Outside of those genres, I partake in everything. And I played way too much in my younger years. Way, way, way too much. Mm-hmm. Both on PC and on consoles.
All right, that definitely makes sense. What would you say was the takeaway from the development of Into the Fray? Sorry to catch myself. I said Shrouded Insanity.
Development wise, don't do top down. it's asking for trouble. Because of the perspective, you have to, at the very least, do three directions per character for every animation, and that's just asking for too much trouble. And then you can say that, okay, but then Moonless Night is also top-down, so what happened with that conclusion? And I would say that we'll get to that, of what happened with Moonless Night, how it was going to be a different game as well, but that was the main takeaway, that if possible, avoid top-down at all costs, unless you have dedicated artists who are willing to die for you.
Yeah, so basically everything we say here is like, it applies to a super small team. So he literally does everything other than the music. I just oversee everything and like give my input if I'm being asked for it. But he does all the coding, he does all the art, except the cover art, which we hired an artist for back then.
And that gets to be a bit much. So, you know, you have to know your limits. And Into the Fray kind of proved it that, no, this is a bit too much. Mm-hmm. I was focusing on different aspects, trying to compensate for the lack of massive variety of enemies and stuff like that. But yeah, don't overshoot your abilities.
Now, when it comes to that whole overshoot things, Were there a few cases where you did catch yourself overshooting, and can you give an example of where that happened and what you did to dial it back?
Well, throughout the entire series, in Shrouded Insanity, for example, it was going to encompass a smaller city, basically, outside of the manor. So half the game would have been in the manor, and the other half would have been in the surrounding buildings in a smaller section of the city. So that had to be scaled down just to the manor. That was one of the major overshoots. Originally, it was going to be straight up top-down, but that was also going to be too much of an overshoot, because I wanted things that are completely frivolous systems, like Shrouded Insanity. It still has an alpha mode where you can actually, it's fully top-down, and you can move furniture around individually, mm-hmm. and you can stack them up to block doorways and stuff like that, which sounds great, right? But it's kind of a gimmick, not really useful, so that had to be cut down. In Usurper, I had to cut down various little features just because they were just too much work, like a bestiary that everyone asked for. The auto map I wasn't ready to make properly yet. It is in Moonless Night now, but there's a lot of these things that just take way too much time for way too small of a return. So, you know, you have to weigh your options. With Into the Fray, it was just the amount of extra side content that I wanted that had to be scaled down. But that was more due to not the development, but more Steam, basically, and the whole algorithm change, you know.
Mm-hmm. Now, with the most recent instance, we have Moonless Night, first thing is going to set itself apart by taking place in a Japanese castle instead of a more traditional Gothic atmosphere. And one of the things I was curious about is that is. There seems to be a kind of hybrid of doing new spins on old mechanics in that one. Was that part of the design that you were trying to take some of the things from the previous games and refine it a bit, or how did some of it come about for Moonless Night?
Okay, so the only reason that Into the Fray didn't have the guard system or an implementation of it was that it just wouldn't fit. You know, it didn't work out, because it's one thing for melee fighting to use a guard system where it's supposed to signify you actually blocking hits and parrying hits. You know, when people are shooting at you, you're not really going to do that unless we go really anime. So I was never going to have a guard system, but I was eager to get back to it and implement on it. And Moonless Night, where Gray is the main character, he's supposed to be the master of defense out of the knights, so it was always going to have the guard system. And through Usurper, I learned a lot and implemented a lot on it. And I think I did change it for much better, to be honest. And I'm really happy with the changes overall. It's just small changes here and there, and new abilities, and just the fact of how health reduction changes the maximum guard percentage as well. Mm-hmm. And it's just always going to be. I always wanted to iterate on it, and I can already say that when the fifth game will happen, that will also feature the guard system. That's one of my babies, basically. And I always wanted to expand on it because you can't really find that anywhere else.
I was just about to say that.
Yeah, you can't exactly find that in any other game. Mm-hmm. It's a unique system, and I definitely want to make it work as good as possible. So yeah, it was always going to have it.
And the other thing that I definitely found interesting, because it reminded me of something that the Elder Scrolls has tried to do, but can never quite get right, in part because it's the Elder Scrolls, is the whole learning through actions kind of thing. Like I've seen that happen with other games. The Elder Scrolls series, especially Oblivion and Skyrim, are certainly the biggest things that come to mind with that, and incidentally have also been punching bags of mine for years. But in this particular case, unlike that or the original version of Final Fantasy II, it's not as easy to cheese.
Yeah, that was intentional. I was trying my best to avoid that. I'm very familiar with the problems in the Bethesda iterations of this. On a base level, I think it's a fantastic idea, mm-hmm. but I seen it basically in no game done well, and I wouldn't exactly count Moonless Knight as done who so so well either, but I did my best to avoid making it exploitable. And I can explain the way I went about it if you want, but it was something that I always wanted to see done in a game, and I just couldn't find it anywhere done the way that it should be, in my opinion.
Yeah, I've seen it done in various ways. I think what helps in this regard, is the fact that a lot of that leveling is going to be taking place within combat, and combat is always going to be have a degree of risk.
Yes.
As opposed to in something like Oblivion, where you could just keep doing an action repeatedly just to level it up.
Yeah, and that was one of my main worries, because I'm very familiar with it, the problems with it. I exploited them myself in all the Elder Scrolls game. Who didn't, you know? Like, you become a master blacksmith by forging the same 3,000 iron daggers, so now you can completely master demonic crafting and stuff like that. So I was always like fascinated on how come that these big studios who have hundreds of millions of dollars to back them, and they can't figure out simple ways to prevent these kind of basic cheese to prevent all this.
Well, I'd say part of it is just a consequence of having so many moving parts involved. It's the same reason why I don't get too harsh on Rockstar when Grand Theft Auto sometimes forgets how physics work. The most infamous example of that being the swing set in GTA 4.
I'm familiar with that.
Yeah, you park your car next to a swing set, and then your car is not there anymore. Mostly because it's a mile away over there.
Yeah. But yeah, I tried to make sure that you can't cheese it. I was also interested in having ways to just instantly get rid of enemies either just push them down shafts and stuff like that, you know, to knock them down into a hole and other stuff like that, mm-hmm. which is always fun in games, I think. I love it whenever you're allowed to just kick an enemy down a big hole or gap and never to be seen again. But the problem with those kind of games is that, oh, if there's a way to instantly kill an enemy and they drop XP or any kind of reward, then, you know, you're just basically turned it into a cheese factory. So with those kind of games, I think it really works well if you can only gain experience through combat. So, yes, I did kick that enemy down the well, but I'm never going to see any loot or experience from it, you know. I did get him out of the way because I don't like him or I don't like dealing with his gimmick. But, yeah, he's out of combat. So I like the kind of freedom it gives. And that kind of brought into my mind that, oh, but then I have to deal with this. So that's why the whole leveling through use came into play.
And, I should note that going with the approach in doing that, well, first off, it's gonna have a haptic degree of feedback because these things that you're using, it's one of those things where just use of it is going to make you better, and also it's reflective of real life. The whole thing of just of practice makes perfect, or rather, perfect practice makes perfect, as my mentor would say. I don't want to go too far into spoilers in regard to it, but what would you say was the learning experience with Moonless Knight? Because unless I'm mistaken, that was the first or not the first instance of putting the game on early access first.
Every single one of them was on early access.
Okay, my
mistake. For shorter to longer periods.
Moonless Knight to be the first one that is not going to early access at all.
But then, yeah, we couldn't wait anymore, so there was no really other choice. But yeah, it was gonna be the first, but in the end, it didn't.
All right, that.
But I would say that early access is generally a great thing, except you can no longer be sure about anything on Steam, and before it was usually before the early access became known as what it is, that, you know, it's a risk. No, you're not buying the full game. And unfortunately, in many, many games cases, they never finish. I'm not going to be in that club, because unless I die, my game's going to get finished and it's going to come out. But now that people know what it is, only people who knew the risk were taking part in early access and actually giving feedback. So it was useful. But once Steam changed their algorithm, nothing can be sure anymore, because now more than ever, it was always the case, but now more than ever, your day one is everything on Steam, unfortunately. It's how the algorithm works. If you immediately don't hit certain numbers, then you're immediately shuffled into, like, nope, you're trash, bye, we're not going to show you. It's the winners win more, the losers lose more. That's the way the Steam algorithm works now. So I don't want to use early access anymore, if at all possible, because you're spreading out, you know, your early sales, and that's actually very dangerous now. So I would say to any other inspiring developers out there to not do it anymore. Mm-hmm. It's very useful, and it's going to be a pain to get people to look at your game without it, but yeah, it's a massive risk on Steam anyway. So if you have access to other platforms, you know, it's safer, but if you're only going to come out on Steam, it's a nightmare.
Yeah, I would. The problem with early access, I think, is that a lot of it's There's certainly been reputational damage due to a lot of bad actors, and some of whom I've given the not so distinct honor of being known as Geek of the Week on the Monastery, which I know some I know some people might say that geek is cool these days, so why would you want to be called Geek of the Week? It's not that kind of geek.
Yeah, I get it.
And
yeah, it's just early access is like we try to like be as well. It's not that early access is like inherently wrong, because you get a lot of like valuable feedback from your customer base early on.
Mm-hmm.
But the thing is, our philosophy as in what we are trying to do is that deliver a full product and for an affordable price and as high as quality as possible within our budgetary and time constraints. And that's part of the reason why we haven't done, this reputation that you just said, part of the reasons why we haven't done any sort of crowdfunding, Patreon, any of that, because of this reputational reasons. Because basically, I wrote my dissertation about how Kickstarter and platforms like that are being misused by people.
Yeah, unfortunately, there as well, fantastic idea, but a lot of bad actors and even unintentional bad actors, like people who didn't set out to run away with Kickstarter money or any kind of crowdfunding money, but they eventually do because they didn't make any games yet, mismanage the money. There's just, how many horror stories there are about this. Mm-hmm. It's endless, and it's still not stopping, and it still keeps happening. So I want to avoid crowdfunding as long as as long as possible.
What are you worried about? What are you worried about swearing for? I told you.
All right. I just don't want
to. And the other reason for that is like, other than reputational reasons, spreading your day one sales again. So it's like people who donate to your Kickstarter are not necessarily going to give you money again on the first day on Steam and so on.
Mm-hmm. I'd rather finish a product and sell that instead of sell promises and maybes. And yes, and I have a track record of finishing things, but I could still have some kind of illness or something, and I don't want to be in the position where I would have to do that, because I work alone, literally no one else will be able to finish the game, so yes, I don't want to
give him feedback on like what I think would go better out of two options and so on, and regards to art and things like that, but like I can't code, I'm not going to finish his coding and all that. Mm-hmm. If it comes to that,
yeah, I don't want anyone to put that money on scene or even like scene, but promises. Things can happen even in the best cases, and this is what I mean, that there are there's lots of cases on crowdfunding where they don't set out to scam or screw people over, but they eventually do, accidentally or not, or just overestimating their skill, or they don't understand how much money it will cost, or they don't manage it well. All these problems, I want to avoid it as much as possible.
All right, that makes sense. That definitely makes sense. Now, I'm not sure how much of this you can reveal, but you're working on the fifth iteration, which is presumed to be the final chapter of this quintology would be the best word. If it isn't, we'll make it a word.
If it's five, then it's gonna be a pentology, right?
Yeah.
Eventually.
Yeah, but I heard quintology before as well, so.
Oh, I don't know anymore.
I don't know.
It's just five games. Five games,
I don't know.
look, if it's any consolation, even linguists that I know personally will lament that English is weird.
It is.
And But a couple of things that I'm curious about is this fifth one going to be firmly in an action based genre, or is it going to be diverging?
Okay, I can reveal easily. There's no secrets going around. Yes, I'm working on currently porting each of the four games to Switch, because it's impossible to miss. You know, you can't miss out on something like this. I will port it to Nintendo Switch and hopefully to other consoles after. They were always ready for this kind of porting because I always supported Gamepad. But I already have the fifth game completely planned out. It's gonna be very interesting, to say the least. You're gonna be traveling like in Usurper. So it's a Metroidvania, but all the combat will take place in a completely separate space, like old school JRPGs, where you know you touch the enemy, no random encounters, but you touch the enemy, or they touch you, and combat initiates. And in that separate space is where all the combat will take place. And if I show you a screenshot, it would look like it's a turn-based game, but it's not. And it feels weird. The closest thing that it will resemble is if you have ever heard of Valkyrie Profile games.
I've heard of them. I still have my copy of the originals.
Okay, so oh, yes. The closest is that. But the combat will be different because it's just one character against all the enemies. So if you play that, you know that that's four characters mapped to the four face buttons on the controllers. Instead, it's one character, so you can immediately see that that will work out differently. But yes, it's going to be a real-time combat system inside that. So it's going to look very weird, and people will instantly think that, oh, it's turn-based, but it's not. So it's going to be unique, I can tell you that much. And yes, it will finish off the five chapter arc of the Skautfold. And I even know exactly what I'm going to do after, further after as well. So it's all planned out, if everything goes well. So I always plan like 5-6 years ahead, so I know exactly what I'm going to do. And yeah, it's in the works. I can share a screenshot with you, and maybe you can put it up in the after editing, but yeah, it would look like it's turn-based, but it's not, and it's gonna be pretty interesting. I can tell you that much. And yes, it will use the guard system.
Yeah, that was another question I was gonna ask, if it was going to use that. And I'd imagine that it's going to have its own twists on that system, in the same way that Moonless Night isn't exactly using the guard system.
Yes,
the complete same way it was used in Usurper.
Yes, I love playing with this system because I think there's a lot of potential there of like twisting it and turning it into like completely different feeling systems. Mm-hmm. And yeah, that's what I'm doing. It's pretty much worked out now, but like I said, the porting comes first for now, because it's just impossible to miss out. To keep, you know, monetarily, it would be a massive mistake not to. So it delays the fifth game, but it is in the works, and it will come eventually, and it will be, like I said, a weird game.
Well, given the fact that I've talked people into buying, I can't really pass judgment on things being too weird or not weird enough, because
Divine Cybermancy is genius. it's such a weird, rough, weird game.
As far as it being genius, I'm not entirely sure about that.
It's a mad genius, but it is. I see the brilliance in it, at least in the eyes of the creators.
I described it once as imagine a bunch of French guys played Deus Ex, then ran Death Watch, and got really high in the process.
Yeah, that's pretty accurate. That's actually very accurate. And it's one of those games where the foreign jank really helps. So you're either going to hate it or absolutely love it. Or at least you're going to have like a really weird kick out of it.
Well, I suffered through Gothic clones, so I'm used to jank at this point.
What, you mean Elix? It's all... Sorry, I love them. I love all the Gothic games. All of them are just super weird.
I love all 5,000 clones of Gothic 2 that they've made ever since.
Yes. That's a running gag, and it is accurate. For better and for worse, but yes, it is accurate. And, I agree with that.
In the case of I suppose it's a bit on the nose to make the Warhammer jokes, because then a few years later they would make a Warhammer game.
Yes, irony, I guess, or poetic justice. I don't know either of those.
I choose to call it life imitating art.
That's a good way to put it. Yes,
but part of the reason I can't pass judgment is some of the weird games that are in my own library that might make somebody go, why the hell would you go with that? I ended up having way too much fun with a story about my uncle.
I actually haven't played that.
I use that as my counter argument when somebody says that you can't do a platformer in first person. Because that's basically what that is. Just imagine if somebody used the grapple beam and made an entire game around using that in platforming. That's basically what that game is.
Ooh, let me bring up my weird tangent about this. This game just reminds me that, can someone already make an actual first-person Souls-like? It's not impossible with a lock-on.
I will take that, and I will raise you one. Do it in the build engine.
Yeah, it kind of could work. I've seen people suggest before that what Oblivion and Skyrim combat system, quote-unquote combat system, would have needed is a good stamina system, like in Oblivion, just actually good. And a lock-on feature, or at least some kind of indicator of whether or not your melee hits would actually be in range, you know? That your swing is in range or not. Just a simple indicator with a lock-on and dodges or like dashes, some kind of, you know, sidestep mechanic or something like that. And it would have been first-person Souls-like.
You want to know what the sad thing is? There was already first-person slasher that had a dedicated lock-on. Oh, all the way back in 2000. Machin X.
Oh. Yeah, they did a lot of... and there's a lot of 2000-era games on PC that were like proto-Souls in many ways. What was it? Dark.
Well...
Dark Ascent.
The one that you showed me not that long ago.
Yes.
If you're thinking of Dark Messiah, aka the first person.
No, not Dark Messiah. Dark Messiah was actually inspiring me a lot on Into the Fray, because I just loved all the kicking and all the weird physics interactions.
Yeah.
I think it's a fantastic weird game.
Like
I don't know. I won't find it right now, but yes, yeah, there were always.
You can yell at me about me not figuring out that one later. The argument that I've often heard is that you can't do proper melee combat in first person, and I think that's complete bunk.
I agree. I think that's completely nonsensical.
The reason why the Elder Scrolls can't do it is because
it's the Elder Scrolls.
Well, there's that, and there's the fact that the most charitable thing I could say about about the creation engine is that it's being held together by spit and prayer.
Yes, I'm still can't believe that they still sticking to that. I understand, as someone who's sticking to a pretty mediocre engine, for better and for worse, it has good features, and I can see why they would want to stick to it, because I did dabble a tiny bit in modding the build engine, and then I saw the good parts. There are many, many good parts. There's no denying that. It is an interesting and powerful engine, but it's also a very weird pile of ancient and archaic code and methodology.
Mm-hmm.
And it's madness. Some parts of it is, it's surprising that it even starts, but in many aspects.
The thing with the creation engine is that they claim it's a new engine, but
it's not.
It really isn't. It's just building upon the previous Gamebryo engine, which was already pretty jank.
Yeah.
But even in the early 2000s, there were means of doing first person melee. I'd rather see it done in a build engine or some sort of old school approach, because one, you can get away with more detailed designs in sprites than you can with polygons. Sprites and voxels. Let me cover all my bases. And two, is the fact that I think with, say, Hexen, you've got the perfect template, like with stuff like Hexen, or more recently, A Medieval, or Heretic. You've got a decent template to utilize a Souls-like setup. And given how you kind of had a roguish approach with a Nightmare Reaper, the foundation is there.
It is possible, but it's really rare to see it even attempted. Mm-hmm. So, and even just small changes to the Elder Scrolls combat could just make it so much better. Like, I understand why they made it as simple as possible for the mass appeal, and it evidently worked, as there's 700 versions of it released on 600 consoles, and even your refrigerator. So, you know, it worked for them money wise, but
Well, honestly, when it comes to making combat that simple in the Elder Scrolls, I think it's 50% the whole mass appeal thing, and 50% spending so much unnecessary, in my opinion, time on the whole procedurally generated world thing, which I think procedurally generated worlds is a overrated design concept.
I would agree, and I would, in general, I prefer smaller handcrafted worlds over massive landscapes that have like just the same amount of actual handcrafted content just spread out with giant gaps of either nothing or just uninteresting content, because everyone who played any of the Bethesda games know that, yes, there's a lot of really good content, and then there is a lot of filler that is like forgettable at best.
Caves for days.
Yeah. The same cave, technically. If you really break it down, you're just going straight, and then you're back at the... you finish the boss or final challenge, and then you're back at the entrance 90% of the time. Because, that's a loop. So, but you're just playing the same thing over and over.
Mm-hmm. And part of the reason I argue that procedural is a bad move simply has to do with the fact that you're putting in a lot of resources for something that you're not going to get a whole lot back.
Exactly.
Oh, the part of the reason that Mass Effect Andromeda had so many problems was because there was that insistence for the longest time of doing procedurally generated planets.
Yep, they were trying to recreate the original vision for Mass Effect 1, which was insane, and of course they couldn't do that. But they tried again, and they tried again on an engine that is absolutely not designed for anything of the sort in any way whatsoever to boot. So they invited disaster twice over, and we all know what happened with that.
Yeah. Well, to be fair, from what, and maybe you can shed some light on this for me. From what I've been told for years, a lot of developers, when they're setting up pit when they're setting up pitches, they will intentionally overpromise and then dial back.
Well, I can't say anything for for that kind of arena where we're talking about hundreds of millions of dollars of budgets and actual publishers like that. But just from what I read and what I heard, that yes, a lot of the project managers were just not care at all whether or not they can do it, their team can do it, because it's the project manager is usually not the one who does it in these massive projects. Like Todd Howard isn't exactly the one who's gonna plant the trees and write the source code. He has done that in the early years of Bethesda, in the very early years, but he hasn't touched any of that in ages. So it's not him whose hard work is actually in. And this is something that I would love to point out, that Ubisoft games are incredibly shallow, massive, gigantic, beautiful, but shallow. And they get a lot of hate, but the developers behind it, and you can see this in every single Ubisoft game. They're like heartless games as they feel to the player. A lot of them come off really dry and heartless. But the developers behind it, they did try. They did try their best, but the upper management decided that no, make it more bland and more gray and more simple. And there's always those people who work really hard. And which is makes me really sad that, like, even with Fallout 76, believe it or not, a lot of love went into that, a lot of hard work. It doesn't show. It's really hard to see that through all the memes and the awful, awful buggy mess that we got,
Well,
and with fair reason, because it's a product that you paid for, so you have every reason to laugh and point and laugh of how absolutely catastrophic that was. But yes, there is a lot of love there. So the developers can and will try. I know that for a fact, even from down here. It's just, management in those massive projects is what determines what's going to happen. If they don't give them the time, if they don't give them the resources, if they don't let them switch engines, which, if I don't know if you're aware that in Fallout 4, in the final DLC in Nuka-Cola, there's one terminal that is. Everyone is arguing that it's a coded message from one of the developers. It's a thinly veiled coded message about Bethesda's internal structure, and it talks about a new attraction that's going to open that is basically naming Starfield, and how the guy who's writing this note is completely baffled how the management thinks that they can open these new attractions with the existing technology. It's so transparent that it's one of the developers who was writing these notes, because we're all aware. I don't know, you're probably aware that in Bethesda they make every developer write at least one or two quests. Even if they're not writers, they will be made to write some quests, do some little dungeons and stuff like that. They say that this is a good creative process, which I can see it working if it creates variety. And in Oblivion, you can actually see this. Some quests that are written by developers, if you check up, are actually pretty good. But it's one of these developers who are like just baffled about the management, how Starfield is gonna run on the creation engine, and it's just unbelievable. So yeah, you always think about the fact that there's a lot of people who worked really hard on those games. Even if it's a bloody mess, it's a steaming pile, it's still there was work there, and you can see that. It just hides under all that,
I will always have a morbid curiosity of exploring those kind of messes, And admittedly, when I mentioned the whole over promise thing, what I was initially thinking of was the design document for the first game in the Metro series, when they were trying to get that to be enticed by publishers, in part because, well, behind in the kindest way I can put it, according to some of the documentaries I've seen, development of the game that Metro was succeeding, Stalker, was a complete and total nightmare.
Yep.
Cut content, outright resentment, many threats between developers, and just a complete and total circus. But I remember reading the document that they had initially planned, and you look at that and you look at what actually came out with 2033, and that document is not exactly what I'd call modest.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that's kind of standard if you want to attract those big purses, so to speak. Mm-hmm. So I wouldn't be surprised if that's standard practice. And again, don't forget that some of those managers, those big names that we're becoming more and more aware with more and more developers speaking out. I will flat out name, like, Randy Pitchford, for example, more and more known for like a dangerous player. He doesn't care about his developers. He doesn't care about the people who work under him. He actively harms them, and, you know, we get these. So it's easy to see that they promise something, knowing full well that the developers will suffer for it, and he will just say, well, just leave, you know. The AAA industry has become more and more hostile, as far as I understand.
Yeah, and I know that some people are saying that there's going to be a crash coming. I don't see that happening, but I do see a crunch/shift happening. Like you,
I would argue that no crash can happen, and the reason for that is that the video game crash of the 80s was a very specific thing in a very specific era where, don't forget, and it wasn't even a full video game crash, it was a console crash. And it was mainly because everyone was just copying the same, by that time, almost 10-year-old games from Atari. Mm-hmm. We're talking about something that is completely to its time, to its setting. You know, video games are so ingrained in our culture now that it's not going to go away, it's not going to crash or anything. But what has been happening since the beginning of the indies is that the talent from those big studios have been running away from the studios, forming their own, money shifting around. You know, all the studios have shrunk significantly. Just think about the output of Electronic Arts. In 2004, for example, they released upwards of 20-plus games. Look at the Electronic Arts of today. Yes, the profits are still incredible in their terms, but they have less and less product, and that also means that more and more risk. You know. So when Anthem failed, it failed spectacularly, profit-wise, for example. When Mass Effect Andromeda failed, it failed spectacularly, because the more and more money you have to pour into a project to keep up with the modern hardware, the bigger and bigger the risk is. And that is why all the talent has been running to indies as well, is that not just the abusive behavior, but it's not like they're going to make so much less money now than they would have in these AAA studios, because it was always the publishers who was pocketing all that big money, after all, you know. And there's no hiding all these inadequacies and these unfairness in the big studios.
I'd say the overall lesson with it is not to underestimate the importance of middle management.
Yeah, definitely.
Because a lot of the issues like crunch and the like, I consider that a failure of middle management more than anything else. But one thing, but yeah, the crash of the 80s was very much a perfect storm where you had the right dominoes fall into place at the right time. And yeah, one of the major factors was having a tie into a very high profile film, and the port to a game that ended up getting so popular it got its own song, both completely shitting the bed.
And never forget that the market was absolutely incomparable. The age range of the actual people who bought the games and the age range of the actual people the video games were made for was very specific and very different, you know, and the amount of games released a year was very different. So I always think that even calling it a video game crash is not the best way to name it, because it was far more a console game crash, and it was far more... It's such a tiny market in terms of, like, variety of content at that time. You know, none of the genres that we enjoy today existed back then, like, yeah, at all. Absolutely none. On PC, they existed, a few of them, but they were so different, you couldn't even compare. So, yeah, that's I think that's never, ever going to happen again, that kind of crash. Well, but what has been seen is that AAA has been shrinking rapidly.
The other thing is, I know PC Engine style hardware was definitely a thing in the UK. Was that also a significant thing in your country as well?
Commodores were incredibly common as soon as they appeared. So that was the first real widespread home PC console. Well, PC hardware that you could get in Hungary. That was really, really widespread. So that was the earliest that you got that. Mm-hmm. But outside of that, it was Atari's. Nintendo only got much later in. And there's something specific to the Eastern Bloc during the communism, which was, it generated, I'm pretty sure no one in the West, well, very few people I have told this know about it in the West, and it was called the Yellow Cartridge. It was called that because it was literally just yellow cartridge, and it was a machine that was made in China and other Asian countries, and transported all across the Eastern Bloc. Even after the walls fell, it was like still the influence, you know, the trafficking and all that was set up during the Cold War. Mm-hmm. They were still bringing the tech in, and the yellow cartridge was an aftermarket Chinese version of the NES with completely illegal games. Obviously, none of them were real games. You couldn't run, some of them could actually run NES cartridges, most of them couldn't. But whenever you got a game for it, it was usually an NES or a very weirdly downscaled version of SNES cartridges, but they were like displaced colors on it. So you would get Mortal Kombat and Sub-Zero would be purple, and Scorpion would be red, and stuff like this. It was just literally...
Also, like, in some cases, it looked like a PC keyboard and you just insert the cartridge in the middle.
It was unbelievable. It's like its own rabbit hole if you want to look into this. The yellow cartridge is a specifically Eastern Bloc thing. Even long after the wall fell, the way the black markets were set up during the Cold War, that remained in a lot of the Eastern European countries. So I experienced a lot of actual original Japanese NES games with bootleg Chinese text on it sometimes, and whatever you got in the cartridge, on the cartridge as a picture, was almost 99% of the time not what was actually on the cartridge. I had cartridges that had 200 actual NES games on it, like from the original Mario to like weird Japanese only games that that kid with the dinosaur that was like a Super Mario ripoff, but so much weird game. I had what was that recently an indie game came out? Rivet City. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I got Rivet City on one of these cartridges in full Japanese. We didn't understand a single word from it, but we figured out the kanji and everything and just went through the menus and played it like that. Amazing games, but completely bootleg and completely crazy. And that was so widespread. Every single one of my friends had one of these because they were incredibly cheap and incredibly black market. But it was so common, nobody cared.
They were like next to trousers and things like that. You buy it there.
Yeah, you would go to like an actual market.
There you go.
and they were like, as I said, mix of NES and SNES hardware in like a fashion I could not even understand today of how they managed to do it, but they did it. And it was incredibly widespread and incredibly cheap. And it was funny to me because when I actually got around to the internet and was looking these games up and learned how it actually was, how I was playing NES games without knowing it. It was just fascinating to me.
Mm-hmm. I always find that kind of thing interesting because, well, even before I was online, I was always researching everything I could like a madman. Like I was always that weirdo who would have no problem being in a library or a bookstore for hours on end. Sometimes going in when they open and not leaving until they close.
Yeah, I really recommend this as a rabbit hole if someone wants to go into this. It's absolutely insane. It's not very well documented. I don't think I've seen a few pictures of it and like a few videos, but it's absolutely amazing. Like
that video where Super Bunny Hop goes to Eastern Germany, I believe, and like he went to a museum of some sorts where there are some weird locally made consoles and games and things like that.
Yeah, but that's more homebrew. That was more homebrew.
That's more homebrew, but mm-hmm. that's very interesting on that note as well.
Yeah, there's a lot of these weird tech in the Eastern Bloc, and that was. Because communism didn't let those games and those technologies in, they did seep in, obviously. They did get smuggled through, and it was like gold. Everyone wanted it, everyone wanted to have it, everyone wanted to try it. I know that when our household got an Atari, of course it was smuggled through, because it was still, the wall was still standing. It was the last year of it. But they got us an Atari 2600, and they were so happy about it, and I was completely fascinated with it. I still completely remember playing the cowboy game on it, for example, where the middle wall was deteriorating.
Mm-hmm.
It was like a very weird iteration on Pong with cowboys and guns, and the Frogger game. And I'm pretty sure that those Atari 2600 were also aftermade, you know, like off market, not real.
And, so, you want to talk about rabbit holes? You could do a full 2-hour dissertation on Pong clones.
Oh yeah, and I know for a fact that cowboy game that I'm talking about on the Atari was just a very weird iteration of Pong as well,
because
you had the wall, which was usually cows and caravans moving up or down on the screen. And the two cowboys on the two sides, but it was basically based off Pong as well. It was using the same control code as well, so it's like fascinating.
Yeah. With that said, as a kind of coda, sorry, English is unfortunately my first language. If there's any bit of advice you could give to somebody who might just be starting out when it comes to learning game design to possibly make their own games, what would that be?
I mentioned it before, but my advice is that I know you want to make the best game ever, and we all have one of those my super perfect plan for the best game ever. We all have our dream game project. But never, ever, ever start with that. I know how hard it is. I know the temptation that you want to do that big thing that you dream of, but never start with that. Start smaller and then cut down and then cut down and then cut down and then simplify and cut down and simplify and cut down. And then you may be getting a product that you might be able to finish, and then you will have to cut down and simplify a few more times, and you will finish it, put it out. And then you will learn lessons that you will never ever learn any other way, because absolutely nothing can prepare you for actually getting a game out, getting the reactions, and you need to know that before you're gonna actually start your bigger projects. And many other devs I heard always talk about this, that always shrink, simplify, cut down, chop off the fat. No, it doesn't, it's not worth it. It's always value of like, how much is this awesome system that I just come up with is actually contributing to a good game? Or is it just a small thing that people are gonna see once, be happy about, and forget forever, and it's just gonna be fat on your game? Because I got so many systems that I had to cut out, and even more should have been cut out, like simplified and focus on the core. And that's, I think, is a very, very important lesson. And many other developers that I listen to on GDCs and other stuff like that always say the same thing, that you need to cut out, you need to simplify and chop off the fat. You can never hit your amazing dream game on the first run. Nobody did. Absolutely nobody. Every one of the big successes as well have made other games before, many of them for years and decades. So, you know, nothing comes from a vacuum, and it's never gonna appear. The first one is not gonna be the perfect game that you envision. You're just gonna ruin your dream game if you're just trying to make it the first time.
Well, doesn't the old adage go, perfect is the enemy of good?
Yeah.
Yes, that too.
Yeah.
I'm just in general the big dream that I'm pretty sure that every developer has this big game idea, this all too complex, amazing, interconnected systems. And no, don't do that. You're hurt. You're going to hurt yourself. You're going to burn yourself out and maybe never finish. Or if you finish, you're going to hate yourself so much for it, because it's not going
to
be what you want.
Think about it this way. Your dream, what you want to achieve, is too important to be your first project when you don't know enough. And you're just starting out in a field.
Yeah,
it's just too important to you, and don't do that as a first project. Do something simple and do something that you are sure that you're definitely able to finish. And the other thing I wanted to say is that as soon as you're able to show something, well, maybe that's not the right word for it, but like flashy and noticeable, start to market your game. And then that will give you better chances of like starting somewhere, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it definitely does. And it's one of those things where sticking to the idea of doing a perfect game is going to lead to ruin, insanity, and just a thing that will never come out. But enough about Star Citizen.
Wow. I could name a few more, but yes, that's one of the big ones. It will come out when it's not going to be impressive anymore.
I have a list that I keep on my wall of things likely to happen before Star Citizen releases.
That is amazing, because Star Citizen, that whole like fiasco when, you know, the article came out and a lot of people like told about, you know, how they were treated with the company and things like that, which was like half of it was true, half of it is not. But anyway, I was like so fascinated and shocked by this whole concept and like the whole industry. As in, you know, I always played games, but like I only started to like familiarize myself with the industry as we started out. It was just so baffling, fascinating, and such a car crash that I couldn't look
at. Yeah, who doesn't like a good tire fire?
I actually written my university dissertation in business management of like crowdfunding, Star Citizen, and all that. Because that was just like the perfect storm of what the hell is happening.
When it comes to the tire fire thing, I think Mel Brooks said it best. Tragedy is when I cut my finger. Comedy is when you fall into an open sewer hole and die.
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah.
Love a good Mel Brooks here.
Yes. Definitely got it.
Because, well, we've all heard the old story about how it's always funny when it happens to somebody else.
You know, my one of my main sayings about Star Citizen was that it will finish, it will be complete, a lot of the features will be in, but by the time it happens, it's not going to be impressive. And it's already showing that because they already had to change out the engine because the graphics were already becoming not too impressive. And, you know, when you have to swap out the engine under your legs, that's seriously like trying to screw a light bulb in while someone switches the seat out under you. So you understand.
From what I understand, the reason they did that is because they, I think they wanted the prettiest looking engine they could get, which is why they went with CryEngine.
Yeah.
But the problem is, CryEngine.
The CryEngine is never meant for anything like that. Yes.
It was never meant for that, and also CryEngine doesn't do multiplayer very well. And I know somebody might bring up Living Legends, but that doesn't count.
Yes, does that tell you? What does that tell you about management and direction and the genius behind Star Citizen? That they were willing to start and develop for multiple years on an engine that they knew full well was not going to work out. So that can go many ways, but that tells me that, yes, it's not in the best of hands. Let me put it that way. And he may be a veteran of decades, but if you look at his portfolio in between his golden age and when he proposed Star Citizen, he didn't do much, and the industry changed a lot. And you know, if you're not participating in a fast changing industry, well, you can see the out of touch nature that some things have been going down there. But I don't want to like get too personal about that, but yes, everyone knows that it's a weird cultish. There's no other way to describe it than it's a cult almost.
They don't like me, so that's definitely a
mark. They don't like anyone who even suggests that it's not gonna be the perfect game. The most best space game ever made, and it's going to be the most immersive game ever made. And that is why it's very important that they model toilets and bowel movements and mechanics, because that's going to make the best space game ever, somehow. You know?
Yeah, it's...
And I'm not against immersion. I love my Arma. I love Arma and everything about it. Mm-hmm. But that has its place, and also, I don't think how Star Citizen will be better by simulating that your need to go to the toilet. It's a good gimmick, and again, I would bring this up that yes, it's a fascinating system. It looks good on paper that you even have that in your game, but does that really make it better?
Or is it worth it? I'm just saying. I think I'll have retired from podcasting by the time the roasting Star Citizen joke gets old. But
Half-Life 3 will come out actually sooner than Star Citizen.
Oh,
I'm almost certain of that now. Now that Alex is out and it's doing so well, and now that meme is gonna die because that game is. Well, whatever kind of next Half-Life we're going to actually get, that's going to come out sooner than Star Citizen, so that's hilarious.
I'll raise you one. Artifact will get a sequel first. Yeah,
oh,
I'm
boy.
Going there. But with that said, I do want to sincerely thank both of you for taking the time out of your busy schedules to come into the temple. And anytime you see fit to come back for whatever reason, the door is always open. And while drinking is not mandatory, it is encouraged.
All right. Thank you very much for having us.
Yeah,
it has been fun.
It was a pleasure.
And of course, a sincere thanks to everybody who took the time out of their schedules to watch. And there will be more insanity coming down the road. But until then, on behalf of the good brothers present and not present, my name is Mildra. I am your gaming monk. Stay fucking frosty, everybody.